So good evening, everyone present here. Today we have with us Dr. Abhirami Prakash, who will be talking to us on sustainable menstruation and the journey of PIRAI. So a brief introduction about ma'am. She's born and brought up in Sivakasi, which is in Tamil Nadu, and she finished her schooling in Sivakasi as well. And she obtained her graduation from the prestigious SDM College of Naturopathy and Yogic Sciences, Karnataka. And after marriage, she moved to Kerala and is currently working in St. Thomas Multispeciality Hospital as a naturopathy consultant. Since 4 years, she's been working along with charity organizations and NGOs on spreading cancer awareness sessions in and around Kottayam and Alappuzha districts and in Tamil Nadu. So such sessions have led her to think about the need for menstrual hygiene sessions and sustainable menstruations in school-going and college-going community. So this led her to start the manufacturing of cloth pads under the name PIRAI. Since 2 years, she has been spreading this awareness in many schools and colleges in Kerala and Tamil Nadu. And she's also been featured in many online and daily magazines. On Your Growth is very privileged to have you, ma'am. I've been following you since I started my BNYS, and I'm very happy to have you on our platform. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you so much. So I'm really very happy to see lots of enthusiastic naturopathy budding doctors who is apart from your clinical, apart from academics, who are interested in you. Because only such crowd of enthusiasm and such initiative or collective of students will give you great support as you go into clinical practice. Okay, so this I'm saying from my experience. So whoever has started this has a very good intention, and whoever has joined hands, and it's a very great thing. So what to today's topic? So almost students, right? So usually I take it to laymen. So common people, I used to take this session. I feel first time when I spoke about it in Enigma Kerala conference, national conference, I don't know if you would have, some of you would have been there.
I was there, ma'am.
You were there. Okay. So that was a very different thing because it is our fraternity, naturopathy fraternity. We talk about nature more than any system of medicine. We have a little more upper hand on the environmental issue because we believe we are so connected to nature. Water therapy, so whatever thing, whatever we say, yoga, breathing. So indirectly, we are connected to the air we breathe. So some pollution there, it is going to reflect in us. So no proper water resources, it is going to reflect in our system, our health. So an allopathy doctor or modern medicine doctor doesn't need to know about it because they're so much far from nature. But being in this field, we have so many things that connect us with nature. So we need to know naturopathy as a lifestyle. Having collected all of you with the same intention, I can tell you that you know the base of naturopathy, right? So we always say return to nature. So if you know SDM, you will know that Marali Prakriti came. So return to nature is the theme of our Shantivana hospital. So return to nature in all aspects. So return to, we are telling the lifestyle, we are telling about food. So naturopathy doctors are teachers, right? I believe so because we don't give medicine, we teach lifestyle. So in that condition, we need to teach them. There are so many things. It could be sustainability. It could be the impact they have on the environment because that is what is going to reflect in our health. So this is very important. So that's why this topic seems very relevant to naturopathy community. Okay. So let me share my screen for the women in full bloom. So today we are going to see this. I don't know, I couldn't keep it as a slideshow. Okay, So what is the thing we need to teach for the women in full bloom? So today we are going to talk about it for 40 minutes. So you all will be having lots of lady patients, right? Both men and women, as a doctor, you need to know certain things. Because for men, common men, they will think about menstruation, about sanitary pad, all these things they will think as just a women's problem. So that's how it is been in the society, right? So they don't talk about it. So whatever they say, it's a women's problem. That's what they want to tell. But as a doctor, even you are a man, you need to know certain things. And you need to understand certain concepts, because we have gynecology as one of the subject. And you will have patients who comes with the irregular menses or gynecological problem, which you need to address. Okay.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So in that condition, even male or naturopathy doctors, both men and women, should know about it. Okay. So what being a woman? So here, why we came into it, the topic was journey of Pirai. So I want to share why we started Pirai. So I was a naturopathy doctor. I'm a naturopathy doctor. But I diverted into many other fields. So when I was only as a naturopathy doctor, so as I said, we are the only doctors who call immediately for an awareness session. Like they say that it's a cancer awareness program. And can you just talk something about it? So we should be ready to talk anything about the disease or management, because all the disease have lifestyle as one of the factor. So anytime you may be called to give a talk. So that's how I started, because my hospital had a cancer awareness program in the rural setup. So I have to go on cervical cancer and breast cancer awareness. So I prepared and I went, I spoke. But after the session, usually we talk about cervical awareness, cancer awareness, that we tell about heavy bleeding and all those things. So when I told them that you have to know the initial signs and symptoms of cancer, one woman asked me, so we don't even know what is a normal volume we have to shed every period, which is normal, then how do we know what is abnormal? So this one question was like summarizing every talk that we do in a society. We don't know how much a woman should bleed naturally. We don't know, many people doesn't know which is the normal cycle, duration of a menstrual cycle. So in that condition, when you talk about cancer, it is like you are skipping first year and second year, going directly to third year and final year. So you can't do much thing, right? You won't understand. So that is what we felt. So that's why we started talking about menstrual hygiene. So as a doctor, you know, like 5 days, it is 28 to 45 days is an average cycle, how much we bleed. We study in physiology. First few chapters of physiology has this. But a common man, how many of you have told this to people who has asked about it or has done a program, right? So we think that everybody knows, but no, not everybody knows this. So that is the thing that made us start something. To make girls, every young girl, 12 years or 13 years, when they start their puberty, we want them to be physically, mentally very happy. I can teach my daughter, but there are a lot of girls whose mom themselves doesn't know anything about it. In that condition, who will be teaching them? Unless there is a problem, nobody is going to a gynec. So only and a doctor like us, who are health enthusiasts, as well as a doctor, can address this. Okay. So that's why we started Pirai. And another reason why we wanted to focus mainly on college and school students is this. So this is a suicide note. So a suicide note of a 7th standard girl. It came in the newspaper in a very small column. The girl was period shamed. Her dress had one drop of blood, menstrual blood, and that her school teacher scolded her so much just a few years back, 5 years back, not very long back. And she came home, even her mom was like, why didn't you take proper precaution and all those things. She was not supported by teacher or parents. She wrote this suicide note. It was in Tamil Nadu. She wrote this suicide note telling that, what mistake did I do to deserve such a bad treatment? I was doing everything perfectly. This is not my mistake. She wrote this and she committed suicide. This came as a very small news, but this was like so much shocking. As a society, we think we do research to reach Mars. We think whether water is there in Mars, and we think we are so advanced. But if we can't give hope to a adolescent girl that this is biological and just that one drop of blood is not going to do anything, and if we can't educate a society, as a teacher, as a parent, on how to handle this or how to remove the stress or how to remove the taboo. The girl was like frightened because it was a co-education school. So what boys will think? So all these things gave her so much stress. So if we can't change anything, or if we can't bring a conversation in this topic, so what are we? We are not civilized. We are nowhere civilized, though we go to Mars. Unless and until we give a safe society or a platform to talk about it, we don't evolve as a society. So that's why Pirai is so vocal about it. We went after this incident, we went so vocal. Earlier, we were like, okay, if somebody gives an opportunity to talk about cervical awareness or breast awareness, then we will talk about menstrual hygiene. That was my thought. I didn't want to go voluntarily and do my awareness. But after this incident, after this girl's suicide note, I decided that no need to wait for anyone to give a chance. I have to do whatever I can. It could be talking to my neighbors, it could be talking to my institution, talking to anybody. So it was like I was in a spree, I could say. I was feeling so bad that I wanted to educate or reach as much adolescent girls as possible. And I just want to tell them that menstruation is not a myth. You are totally safe. One drop of blood will not take your life. This message I want to give, just three messages. Yes, every woman are going through menstruation. This is not a big issue. It's just biological. This three information I wanted to spread to as many schools as possible. So that was my intention, and that was Journey of Pirai started as a menstrual hygiene program. So the problem here we have is we have lots of taboos. Okay, I assume there are a lot of people from Karnataka, right? Because SVASA is in Karnataka, I assume so. But still, if you are a crowd from anywhere in India, you will know that you have lots of myths. For example, menstruating women should not touch the pickle, should not keep a flowering plant, touch a flowering plant, or don't enter kitchen. There are so many things. In Kerala, you are not supposed to take water from water well. So there are so many things. But who will tell whether it is a myth or fact? So only we have to tell. A doctor has to tell that. There is no scientific proof. Even if you may be having some doubt whether it is a myth or fact, you can try planting any tree. You can touch your pickle in your periods. Nothing will happen because we don't have any chemical or toxin from our body during menses that makes us different from others. Earlier, there were restrictions only for hygienic reasons because people were free bleeding then. There was no sanitary napkin or anything. So they were left in a room and they were allowed to bleed. And then they were, earlier it was only a river bath. They have to go to river to take bath. So for hygienic reason, all the 5 days they were kept in a room. And after that, they used to take a bath in the river or a temple, something like that. They had ponds in temple. They have to take bath and then they have to come to home. So this was a norm for a purely hygienic purpose. But the same thing doesn't apply now because we are working. We can't skip days. You can't sit in a room like that. Now, with all the hygienic thing, we are totally able to do everything that we can do on other days. Okay, so this is a myth that you have to break amidst your patient. Another thing is, this is what I told, being vocal about it. For example, I have seen a lot of adolescent girls, even if they have periods, they will tell in a very hushed voice, "Amma, I got periods." Okay, so at some point of time, we have that thing called, it should not be spoken publicly. So how it reflects in clinical practices, you get a cervical cancer patient at the final stage. So only when at the severe stage of cancer they come, because they assume it is normal to bleed, especially during menopause period, they will ask the people nearby, "So I have heavy bleeding, is it okay?" So they may tell from their experience that it is okay and why you are worrying about it. So in that condition, they may skip it. So these situations cause a very worst impact. So that is the reason menstruation should be discussed. They should know what is normal from adolescent. They should know if they are skipping the cycle, if they have heavy bleeding, what it implies in their health. So all these things can be spoken only when people get very vocal with menstruation. It should not be a taboo topic, like, okay, we should not talk about it. So when they don't talk at home, we will never know how they have the problem. So why do we need to talk? That's what we were talking now. Women feel embarrassed. For example, you may have an office or somewhere, you want to change a pad and you want to go to restroom. So what do? You have to hide your pad, call few of your female friends, then you will all go together, go hide the pad and you go and change, right? So this is what we have been doing always, right? So such a kind of embarrassment in workplace, education institute, either be college or anywhere. So this thing is a very bad thing. Like we don't have proper setup anywhere for women to go and change their pads also. So such a fate we have. And 71% of women doesn't have any knowledge. Though it is in our biology textbook in higher secondary, nobody teaches this because they feel that teachers, especially teachers, think that in a co-education setup, teaching them about menstruation will attract criticism from boys. They may tease them. So all these things. But from my experience, I have been taking for boys also, but nowhere I have felt them as an intrusion. They always say, "Doctor, we never know it." I used to tell, your mom goes through this. If you have a sister, she goes through this. And your friends. So boys are not bad. That is my experience. Only when we don't teach them things. For example, in a home, if a sister, elder sister or younger sister, if they attend puberty, obviously the brother, he used to ask, "Amma, what is happening to Akka or your sister?" So what mom says, "This is none of your business. Go away." Right? So in that situation, if a mom is telling, "See, this is uterus. So this has this function. And so your sister is going through this. And she may be having every month like this. She may have physical and mental changes." So if a boy said all these things, obviously the way he looks at women will be different. Right? While going in a public transport or a waiting place, he won't be tempted to tease women or harass them or stalking. All this can be avoided if the man knows really what a woman goes through. But unfortunately, a mother or a teacher who should teach this, they don't teach it. So men are romanticized from movies. They think women is a substance or an object. That's what is shown in all the movies. So they try to act accordingly. So if we give them correct knowledge, they will become a responsible men in the society. Am I right?
Yes, ma'am, totally.
Yeah, totally. Because I see only blank spaces. I was like, who really? If it is a real meeting, we can see faces. Now I can see only this one. Okay. So what does a woman need to know? So we need to talk. So like we have some 48 participants here. I'm assuming that each one of you will be ready to do a content on this. It could be a Facebook page, Insta page. You may write it, or you may talk about it, or you may be invited to give a lecture on it, on women's health. So what do you want a woman to know? So first thing, how much a woman bleeds? What is the duration of a healthy menstrual cycle? Is the menstrual pain normal? Dysmenorrhea. Okay. So all these things you have to know. Assuming that you all know the answers for this, right? Right? Okay. So the normal amount of menstrual blood is just 80 to 100 ml. This is very important to tell the people, because I have seen so many people. They used to say it is half liter, 1 liter. You will be surprised. Just ask this question in your circle. You will get very interesting answer. They used to tell 1 liter, 2 liter. So you should make them understand that it is just this much. Because all the advertisement commercials that we see in television, they show sanitary napkin being poured beakers and beakers of blue liquid. Luckily, they have changed into a red liquid recently. Earlier, it was a blue liquid. So one of the session I had with young girls, so that girl was like, she attended puberty recently. I asked, how was it? Like, what was the fear she had? She said, in advertisement, they show blue liquid, but when I got my menses, it was red. So these are the doubts like small kids have when they have puberty. So it looks funny, but that girl was so scared. Advertisement shows blue liquid. Why am I getting red? Luckily, now they have shown red liquid. That is good of them. So you should make people understand that it is only this much. It's not so much. If ever they have so much fluid, they have to get a medical cup. This one. So how do you measure? You can't ask them, right? So how do they know is, you can see that 9 to 12 pads is normal. For a woman in a month, if she uses 9 to 12 ultra pads, it is normal. If it is more than that, it means that she is having heavy bleeding. And if it is consequent for 2 months, then she has to check with the gynec. For if she has fibroids or endometriosis or any other problem, she has to consult. Okay. And duration. So you all know 28 days is a norm. But everybody, does they get 28? No. So it ranges from 25 to 45. Excuse me. So 25 to 45 days is, anybody getting every month 25 days is normal. 45 days is also normal. But 1 month 25, next month 45 is not normal. So when somebody tells you a gynec history, you should ask whether they are regularly irregular or irregularly irregular. Because when I started my practice, if ever a woman doesn't get 28 days periods, I was thinking that she has a problem. But later I understood that there are people who get once in 45 days or once in 50 days. That comes by practice to know which is normal, which is abnormal. So this you should know. And severe pain. So dysmenorrhea, you have to see if a woman can do her day-to-day work. Like, for example, if she's going work or if she's a homemaker, if she's able to do every work, then it's not a very severe pain. But if she has to take painkiller, if she skips her work, she has vomiting, diarrhea, migraine along with that, then it means she has severe pain, has to do something. Either it could be that she may have to go for a gynecological evaluation. She has to check her hemoglobin. Is there any hormonal imbalances? Does it can be corrected by diet or yoga or stress? All these things has to be checked. Okay. So you all know the cycle, right? So what happens in a menstrual cycle? That's ovulation, when there is no implantation. So there is going to be shedding of the endometrium. Okay. So this shedding of the endometrium is what we call menses. It's okay, right? I can go this speed because you all medical students. So I think this will.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Fine. So this one you should make every woman to track. So what is tracking? Do you all track your cycle? You have a lot of apps now. Yeah. So this tracking is very, very important. So I think there are a lot of men here. So I'll tell you, this premenstrual syndrome is real. So it could be your mom, your sister, or your friend, or your girlfriend, anybody reacting out of irritation and frustration. Just first check whether they are going through their PMS. I have seen in a lot of session, I tell the male, whether you are a husband or you are a friend, your father, just know your cycle of your women in your life, whoever is living with you, that is important. Because at some point of time, you may be thinking, I just said a simple thing and it became a big fight. It may be because she's going through premenstrual syndrome. That's because of the hormones. So that is real. It is not fake. There are people who say that it is just a premenstrual syndrome is nothing, but it is real. There is estrogen and progesterone happening because nature creates man so beautifully and there is nothing without any purpose. For example, first 15 days is our estrogen cycle, right? Till the egg is released. So in that time, you can see that a woman is so outgoing. She likes to talk. She likes to dress up very colorful dresses. She likes to speak to opposite sex. They feel like attractive. It is not conscious. It is subconscious. They feel very party type. They talk a lot and all those things. Only till ovulation, because nature wants you to select a person or a mate. And that is what it does in all species, not only human beings. Every organism has this impulse. But after ovulation, nature doesn't want you to be jumping person. It wants you to be serious, because once a baby is implanted, you have to be careful. You have the responsibility of a mom. So that is why progesterone takes over. Progesterone is a serious motherhood hormone. If you're pregnant, this hormone is going to continue all throughout your pregnancy. If not, the 15 days, last 15 days, you are going to feel the pressure and stress of motherhood. That is why we feel so responsible. Like some days during PMS, I have heard girls who feels like, I feel like crying. I feel like I'm at the bottom of my mood. Like you just feel like I can die. And you will be knowing as a medical student that migraine attacks, asthma attack, depression, everything aggravates, maniac depression, psychosis, everything aggravates in the last 1 week of menses. A lot of women commit suicide in the last week. That is the reason, because the progesterone is so strong that so they couldn't control the mood. The tracking is important because once you know that this is just a cycle, after 1 month, I'm going to be back to normal. If you know that, you will not feel this tension, right? So when a girl feels so depressed and she knows that after I get my periods, I'll be happy. When my estrogen comes up, I'm happy. She will not bother about it. She will just sleep or cry and she'll get over it, right? So we can prevent suicide with just one piece of information. So that is why the role of a doctor is very important. It is not just diagnosing a disease. It's also teaching them proper lifestyle skills. So one of them is tracking. So if a woman can track her cycle either in an app or in a calendar or in her journal, draw, write or something about it, within 3 months, she will come to know what exactly is happening in her body, when her mood is high, when her mood is low. So based on this, she can make her life choices. Okay. I wish all of you practice this and make your patients also. So this is all effect of hormones. I'm not going in detail, as you know everything. So the pain during menses. So you will know the naturopathy management, right? So hot fermentation, hot food immersion is the best thing. Hot food immersion, hot fermentation, cold compress or wet pack all throughout the days, not only on the 4 days of periods, all throughout the days, if they are going to use that, their periods will be very less painful. We have seen it in day-to-day life. So a lady tracker, there are a lot of tracker. You can draw a picture, you can write, but somehow track your mood, physical and mental changes. Just you can see the mobile, there are so many apps. Okay. So that is about menstruation. So why do we keep getting these messages? I think waiting room is open, but it is also coming with the notification tone. Can somebody admin off the notification tone?
You can switch off that sound in your mute, meeting setting.
Okay, I hide. Okay. Okay. So can you see my slide now in
yes,
full screen? Okay, thank you so much for the info, Ma. I was not knowing. Okay, so now you got your periods. We spoke about tracking and all this. So what is in your pad? So what is in your pad? This is the second part of Piraya, I could say. We did a menstrual hygiene session we were doing, but we were not convinced with the sanitary pad. So I have been personally using a cloth pad since some 7-8 years when my daughter was born. Because when my daughter was born, I was like, I didn't want to give her this plastic pad. So when she was born itself, I was thinking that I should find an alternative. So for that first, I should know what it is. So I was trying all the alternative, different types of pad, like a bio recyclable pad. So many things I tried and finally came to a cotton cloth pad, which can be washed and reused. So I was so happy with it. So each time when I go for a cancer awareness program, cervical cancer or somewhere, so they used to ask me, I used to tell about my experience with the cotton pad. So they used to ask me, where should I get it? Unfortunately, we don't have many shops where they sell cotton cloth pad in India. We have to order online. So that's how after 2-3 years of talking, when people, so many people were asking, and we don't have a proper choice to give them, like you go here, you get the pad. So that's why we ourselves started, my mom and my sister, we as a team, my mom is very good in managing and she's good in stitching. So that's why we started very small. Now it's going on well. We have a set of stitching unit in Shivakasi and we have a manufacturing unit and we dispatch pad in WhatsApp. We get orders in online and we dispatch like that. So that is a complete story of Pirai, how it came. So why it came is the thing, knowledge about what is in your pad. So what exactly is in your pad? So this is the sanitary pad that we get in the market, right? So it has SAP, super absorbent polymer. It is like a gel. You might have seen a very small plastic bead kind of thing. When you put it in water, it used to swell. I've seen it. So we might have seen in Chinese bamboo, that decorative things, we get it like, it is a gel kind of thing, but it can absorb so much water. That is super absorbent polymer. Before it was discovered, people used to have thick pad. Okay, but when this polymer was found, they made it very thin because they used to put this particles there. It can absorb 30 times its weight. 30 times its weight in the sense you have thin pad for so much time. So when the commercial says 12 hours protection, we'll be like, wow, 12 hours we can be without any problem of changing it. The thing is, what it does to the health. Unfortunately, we are so much concerned about comfort. Many times we don't question whether it is really healthy to us. In India, the government doesn't do that, putting ourselves in a risk. There are no one single scientific paper that tells about the chemicals used in the sanitary pad and how it affects the reproductive health. This is very unfortunate. There is only one research paper that is funded by Whisper India. So you can very well decide its authenticity. Okay. And next thing, people say it has cotton, right? So even in advertisement, you might be thinking that it has cotton, but does it have cotton? It doesn't have cotton. It has a cotton-like structure, okay? So this is like Johnson & Johnson. Have you seen cotton? It is like a plastic, nylon kind of thing. It's not. So actually, it is a wood pulp. A wood pulp that has been bleached to get the white color, and that is used in the place of cotton. Do you know how much is a cotton chudidar or sari? Girls, there are a lot of girls. You can just answer. If you want to go for a pure cotton dress, how much it cost?
Around 1,000.
So in a country like India, do you think they will keep cotton in sanitary pad, which comes with a pack of 10 at 30 rupees? No, right? So that's what we need to think. Where does it get the supply? So it is true that it is not cotton. It is a bleached cellulose wood pulp. So to bleach, they use dioxin. Please take a screenshot of it, and you can Google on SAP, Google on dioxin, and just see what is in a commercial sanitary napkin when you find time. Okay, so this is all about it. Okay, so what happens to this? Why we shouldn't use it? Because we started using it from cloth, like our mom and grandmom was using cloth. Why did they change it? Because of the convenience. Because cloth, we need to wash it. It becomes very hard to wash. And when we work outside, we need to change it. We can't stick it. We can stick this pad in our panty, but that cannot be fixed. So these were the problems we faced. So from cloth, we changed. So, but what happens to the health? First thing, vaginal irritation and rashes. You would have seen a lot of people complaining it. You may be having, after periods, many people can't walk for 1 week. They will have rashes in the skin. Contact rashes. So they have to put this coconut oil, lotion and everything till they get it right. Second thing is allergy. Some people are allergic to the chemicals in the pad. So dioxin, it could be SAP, it could be. So they have a lot of problem because of allergy. Even some have vomiting because of it. And it is proved that this SAP, super absorbent polymer, has a property of endocrine disruptor. Can you believe it could cause diabetes? It could cause any hormonal imbalances, abdomen pain, vomiting. Some say it can even cause diabetes. So what happens is every month we are using it, right? It comes in contact with the skin, especially vaginal skin is very sensitive. It is not like the skin that we have in our hand. So when the vaginal sensitive skin is exposed to such chemicals, not once or twice, almost for 15 years till menopause, when a woman is being exposed to repeated chemical exposure, it causes a lot of difference in their vaginal cells. Okay, so it may cause itching, reddening, pain in the abdomen, vomiting, headache. So there are a lot of problems in the health aspects. But we can keep health as a personal choice, because as a naturopathy doctor, we know that we tell so many things, but not everybody follows it, right? You tell about diet or lifestyle, but very few people follow it. So in that case, we can leave them to do whatever with their health. But what happens to the environment? So you use a sanitary pad, fold it and put it in the dustbin, wrap in a newspaper. That is what we are taught. But what happens to the sanitary pad that we throw in the dustbin? Where it goes? Has anyone thought about it? Because each time when I was using this pad, when I throw it, I'll be thinking like where it will go. So after 3 days, where it will reach? How they are going to dispose? All these things will be running in my mind. When I found that it will never get eradicated, I felt so scared and I just stopped using it. Because as single women, 15 years to 50 years, throws a 150 kg of sanitary napkin in her lifetime. So there are 355 million women menstruating in India alone. So each woman throwing this much waste will be like 10 pyramid. So pyramid is a huge structure. We will have dump as much as that. But unfortunately or fortunately, not all these women use sanitary pads. Still for poverty reason or for many other reason, many people are using only cloth. So that is, they are the one who is protecting us from dump. So how long does a single pad take to decompose? Can you just imagine? Can anyone answer me? It takes 500 to 800 years, almost a 10 generation. So this is social. So my son used to tell me, earlier days when they are going to build a home, they used to dig the ground, right? So they used to get treasure boxes from inside the earth. So future, when our kids or 10 generation, when they dig, they are going to get your sanitary pad if you are someone who is putting it in the ground and closing it with mud, because it is not going to decompose for 500 to 800 years. It's just going to stay there. Okay. So that is the environment. So how does it impact socially? So you may be thinking, as a doctor, why should I think about its social impact? Because we are in this. We are not just a doctor. We are a daughter. We are a mom. So we are everything. As a society, we have these roles also. So gender equity is very important. So when a man knows all these things, he will have a responsible, not only for the health of his women in the life, but also the environmental hazard. For example, you have a road where either side is dumped with plastic and sanitary waste. Do you think only women goes in that road? No, right? You have men also going. So they also have, it is not a women's problem, first thing. It is a men's problem also. So it's a human problem. We all are throwing dump and everybody should do together. It's not just women cannot do this, because women are not in many policy making in government. So it's a men's world many times. So even men should know the impact of this. Only then it can bring change. Second thing is rape culture. It's a very big topic. But when a woman is stopped talking about all these things to her own father, like they tell, no, after puberty, you should not tell to dad or brother about anything. It's your body. Keep it as a secret. Only when they start keeping it as a secret, when there is some abuse, when there is someone who is harassing them, they don't tell, because they are made to believe that after puberty, body is something very secret thing. So we should not tell about anything. So talking about menstruation will make the girls open more about their abuses. So we can protect the children. Child abuse can be prevented. They will be more open to talk and discuss, and they will heal. So this is second thing. Third thing is, my waste is my responsibility. Right? So you use something for your benefit, either it could be a dress or a sanitary napkin or anything, but whatever it comes out of it, it is your responsibility, right? It should be in your home. You should be able to manage it. You should not pass on to your kids. Like if it is my home, I keep digging and putting all the waste. After your time, lifetime, your kids are going to be in the same home and they are going to be in the same dustbin or dump. So this, we have to think about it. So when we think my waste is my responsibility, we will choose products very carefully. Okay. So that is what social impact can do to this. So we spoke about all these things. Now, what is sustainable menstruation? So what we can do? We spoke about all the problem. What is the solution? So we have only two solutions. Okay. So we have a menstrual cup. So this is a menstrual cup. I think you would have seen, a lot of people would have seen. So I need not go deep into it. So a menstrual cup is made up of medical grade silicone. It can be used, a single cup can be used for 10 years. It can be pinched like this there are different techniques. This is one of the technique. You keep inside your vagina, it opens up, blood gets filled in it. Then you are going to pull it out, drain it, wash it, and reuse it. After 5 days of your periods, you are going to sterilize it by putting in hot water. Then nicely dry it, put it in a bag like this, a pouch, use it for next month. So this saves 10 years of your sanitary pad. Okay, this is one thing. Second thing, if you have a mental block, because I recommend cup, but I don't use cup because I have a mental block of putting anything intravaginal devices. I it's a different thing because I had my cesarean section. So that is a mental block for me. So there will be a lot of people like me. So what you can do is you can use a cloth pad. So this is a cloth pad. Cotton pad, there is nothing like any chemical in it. This is a sanitary pad, just like in the shape of sanitary pad, but it is cotton, just like your panty with so much layers. Only this is, this material is very easy to wash and it is not hard and it is very soft. It has an anti-leak layer. So it's something like this, like you can see here. It's a polyurethane laminate, like it will be inside your raincoat, no? So like that, after repeated wash for 2-3 years, this will break. So after it is breaking, you can dispose this sanitary pad. How to dispose? Just burn it. It will go to just like ashes, it will go. Okay. In this, we have different thickness, different sizes, bigger, smaller, all these things. Okay. And there is another model. Like some people, we used to tell that you have to put it in sun. That is very important, or else it is not hygienic. So when they can't put this shape as in the terrace, right, they will be telling what people will think. We need not worry about it, but people still worry about it. Then they can use something like this. It is like a towel, right? But it has an anti-leak layer here. Just looks like a kitchen towel. You have to fold like this. And you get a pad like this. You have buttons. Keep it in panty. You have to put it like this. You have different layers. Thick layer, thin layer, night for everything you have. And you wash it. It looks like a towel and you can put dry it. Okay. So this is another model. So this is how a menstrual cup looks inside your vagina. So it just fits inside. So there are a lot of doubt, like people ask whether they can pee. Whether it is going to. So you should teach them that the urinary orifice is different. So vagina is different. This all thing, you first learn it, then you can teach others. So regarding cloth pad, after all these years of telling, I have collected few questions. I will ask it, then you will understand what exactly you will know. Is it hygienic? Because many of my doctor friends, who used to tell that? Gynecs, they used to tell that it is not hygienic. But we have seen that after many years of use, I have cut the pad to see the internal layers. It is not at all having any problem. It is not any strain is there. Because when you wash it properly and dry it in sun, it is totally hygienic. Okay. Second thing, earlier people used to dry it in a very dark places. As I said, it is a very taboo to put this cloth anywhere else. People should not see it. So they used to put it in a very dark place and it may prone to infection. And if it is a dirty cloth, whether it has some pin or any rust, it will cause infection. Okay, septicemia. So that is why a gynec doesn't want to take a risk. So they tell that directly go for sanitary napkin. But if you're using a nice cloth, properly maintained, it is totally hygienic. Is it difficult to wash? No. Basically, I'm a very lazy person. I hate washing by hand. So when we started doing this experiments on selecting a material for pad, my first thing was it should be easy to wash, first to me. So we tried some 50 material to check whether it stain goes fast and all those things. So one of the factor we wanted it was it has to be easy to wash. So this, we just can show in the tap for all the blood to go. Soak in soap water for 10 to 15 minutes. Then you can wash soap brush. That is enough. You can just It's very easy. Does it leak? No, it does not leak. You can use it for 4 to 5 hours if you have a normal bleeding. If you have heavy bleeding, you may have to change, just like other pad. But if you don't have a very light bleeding, you can use from morning to evening. There is no problem that you have to change always. Because in other sanitary napkin, even if you are not using, even if you don't bleed, you have to change once in 4 hours because of the chemicals, right? This is just cotton. You can just use it anytime. So how to change, like when you are outside? So I travel a lot, and this is something I carry with me. So this is, you are using this pad, okay? Now you are in train or somewhere outside. You want to change. What you can do? You can just hold it. Put the button in the front side. Put it. It becomes like this. Put it in a pouch. Pull the string. Keep it in a cover or something. Keep it in your bag. Take it home. You can dip it in water for maybe 1 or 2 hours. You may have to dip it, soak it, and then wash it. And easily, it will be okay for the next wash. Okay, this you can do. So these are the washing instructions. Important thing is you should not use hot water. Because every time they used to think that when there is a strain, we used to soak in hot water, right? Blood has hemoglobin. Globin is a protein. When you use hot water, it becomes very hard stain. It doesn't go from your dress. So always use tap water. Don't use hot water. Okay, so this is one thing. So there are different sizes. We ourselves have 3 sizes in thickness, and we customize also. So there are so many, but it's not just a Pirai. There are so many pads. You can Google, you can check their products. I'm just giving you what we have. So this is what we were talking. Do men need to know menstruation? They should know, because we are not from different planet. We are destined to live on earth together. Women are in the family, as a friend, in a public forum. We meet women, teachers. We work with women. So they should know what a woman goes through. If possible, they should make the environmental friendly, especially when they go through periods. Like there are a lot of places where there is no restroom facility. So women are so concerned. What will happen if 1 drop of blood is in my dress? What a man sees it. So a man have to make an environment very friendly, that even if it is a drop of blood, it's no problem. It is not a very life-threatening thing. Okay, so men need to talk about it. So this you can take a picture or screenshot of it. This is the contact of our, this one, Pirai, if you want to order. And you can Google of cotton sanitary pads, reusable. You get a lot of things. Google through it, get your knowledge about the product, change to any pad, and this is about Pirai. So we believe that every great change in the society starts with a small change in ourselves. When I started using cotton pad, my only thing was I should not throw 150 kg from my home. That was my only intention. I didn't have any plans to tell to others. But when we do start something, people start talk about it. People ask, like my own family members started asking, why you are using this, and my friends. So it became a big movement. Now with Pirai, I think 3,000 or 3,500 kilo of sanitary waste we have prevented in just 2 years. We have that many customers. That was a very happy thing. Okay, I just meant for 150 kg. And when this 3,500 kg, it is a bonus. So if each one of you can change it, and if each one of you can change somebody, it's a great change. That's how the society changed. Okay, so the let the change start with you. Thank you. So I think now we can go for questions.
Yes, ma'am, we'll take up the questions now. So the first question from Shruti, are menstrual cups and tampons hygienic and preferably because it's a foreign body and won't it irritate our vagina and cervix? Will it cause any inflammation?
Tampons will, because tampons use the same cotton-like material as we use in sanitary pad. Okay, so it absorbs the moisture from the vagina. That is what it happens. It causes so much dryness, just like sanitary pad. So tampons are not good because it is a absorbing material. But menstrual cup is not an absorbing material. It is a collecting device. Like you just are going to keep it and you are going to remove it. That is nothing happening. It's just a physical, this one. But again, menstrual cup is safe. But if you have endometriosis or fibroid, in that condition, you can't use a menstrual cup. So if you have that thing, you can obviously go for a cloth pad.
Okay. So the next question is, are there any effective home remedy for treating heavy menstrual bleeding and nausea, vomiting in emergency?
See, heavy menstrual bleeding is a clinical symptom, but we should know the cause of it. It could be anything. It could be fibroid. It could be endometriosis. So in that condition, whatever you can check the symptom, like a cold abdomen pack you can use. You can use pomegranate juice and all those things. But unless and until you don't stop the cause, every month you cannot do the thing when you have a fibroid inside, right? So you have to address the fibroid. You have to check hormonal imbalances. Then you have to advise some dietary restrictions, weight reduction. Only then, heavy bleeding during menopause is normal. But even in that condition, we have to make sure that their hemoglobin is not coming down. So as a naturopathy doctor, you have to know the symptom, but at the same time, we should not be ignorant of the diagnostic method. I have seen a lot of people who just say the symptom, but they don't advise them for diagnosis. So we are not very experts like earlier naturopaths to check the pulse and find the disease. We are still on the process, right? So we can ask them to take a blood report, ask them for a hormonal assay, ask them for a complete blood check. So with that, you will get a picture of what is happening inside the body. So based on that, always try to treat the cause, not the symptom. Heavy bleeding is a symptom. Okay.
I hope that answered your question, Lalit. So the next question is from Namita. And she asks, is it normal if a menstrual cycle changes for 2 to 3 days every month? I think it's like plus or minus 2 to 3 days every
month. 2 to 3 days every month is okay. That means that your cycle is somewhere between 25 days. So every month when it is 31 or 30 days, obviously you will get 2 to 3 days earlier. Okay. So 2 to 3 days of change is okay. It could be because of your stress, because of the food habits. More than that is a problem. If 2 to 3 days, it will not be a problem.
Okay. So the next question is, Shruti says, I have seen those material of bleached wood pulp, the so-called cotton-like in organic pads too. So how do we choose a proper safe pad and what criteria should we look for?
See, I don't believe in this biodegradable thing at all because there are a lot of people who tells that it is biodegradable. You have to get a pad. You just have to see whether it is really biodegradable. Because there are a lot of my friends who work in this. I think you will be knowing Rajeshi. Asuma will be knowing, I think. Rajeshi, I don't know. Just check on my page. She will be there in my thing. She's the one who is doing a lot of research on it. Like she really buys pad and she decomposes and sees whether it is decomposing in 3 months. But she says most of the pad doesn't work like that. They say within 2 months it will decompose. But decompose in what circumstances? You need a proper compost. You need the soil to be in that texture. You need the oxygen. When you ask them that it is not decomposing, they will tell that your soil is not good. Okay, there are so many things. In some part, you have to stripe the outer layer and then you have to decompose. Will you do that? After we use a pad, how many of you will stripe the back layer and we won't do that. Not every time. So a biodegradable pad has its own limitation. You can use it when you are traveling or somewhere. Like you can't avoid a reason to use a disposable pad. You can use it, but always check whether it has, what are the ingredients on it. Like there are P-Safe or something, some brands are there where they say that they use pure cotton. But they claim the price to be very high, but I don't know whether it is really cotton. Then that you have to check, you have to buy and see, I think. Because my experience, my friends, many people have said that it is not as much as they claim. Okay, it may be better for health, but environmentally, I don't think. Because we put it in a polythene bag and we throw it. And that
then
polythene
no
bag...
in getting decomposed.
Yeah. The polythene cover takes years to decompose. Only then the what is inside thing is going to decompose. So that is how the problem comes.
Okay, ma'am. So Alexa asks, how to manage PMS, mainly headache, mood swings?
Hormonal imbalance, mainly high junk food. If you crave for salt, high chocolates, it means that you are deficiency of magnesium or you are deficient of some micronutrients. Only then you will have cravings. Okay. And do yoga regularly. This I have seen with a lot of my friends. If you do yoga regularly, you can very well control your PMS. And last thing, try to put a cold hip bath. If you have a hip bath tub in your home, you can use that. Or else use a cold compress. Just dip a towel in water, fold it, put in the abdomen daily. Other than the days you have periods, every day early morning 20 minutes, this will very well control the pain. Mood swings, you have to do yoga.
Okay, ma'am. So the next question is, Kalpana asks, how can we go through acupuncture in order to alleviate pain, discomfort, irregular bleeding and during menstruation? If so, what points can be used?
See, acupuncture works beautifully in hormonal imbalances. Okay, that is my very, I study traditional acupuncture, so I love it. But thing is, it won't alleviate if you are giving pain relieving point, you can relieve it pain for temporarily. Okay. But if you really want to go to the root cause of it, you have to take a proper history. I don't know which text you are referring, whether it is a Jayasurya or Agarwal, I don't know. But if you are referring Agarwal, I'll recommend you to see Jayasurya. Because Jayasurya's text is mostly into traditional yoga, traditional acupuncture principles. So all the spleen meridians, spleen 6 is the best point for dysmenorrhea. Spleen 6, spleen 10, okay, stomach 44. All these points are awesome points. Spleen 6, especially for all the menstrual irregularities, PCOD, painful menstruations, very good. Even when you have periods, if you have dysmenorrhea, if you can't give a needle, you can give acupressure. Even that works. Okay. So it is a very big topic, but acupuncture works. If you just, you can direct message me if you have any other doubts. This is a very big topic to discuss on. Okay. But it works.
Okay. So the next question is from Neha. She says, as you have mentioned, ma'am, about the cotton cloth bed, but in case of emergency, how do we tackle the situation of disposing the used one? So I think this question was answered by ma'am.
You can just burn it. It doesn't do anything.
So in case of emergency to dispose it, you ask us to just clap,
If you are, that is not emergency. If you are traveling somewhere, you just can put it in a pouch and bring it home and you can wash it. And in case of really, if you can't do anything with the recyclable one, you have to, that time you can go for biodegradable pad. You can see whether it works. I don't know, but you can try it.
Okay. The next question is from Padmavati. She asks, do we need to visit gynecologist before using a menstrual cup for its selection?
If you can yourself, there are a lot of website and a lot of videos which will help you to suggest correct pad, correct cup. Okay, because it has a lot of like this. There are thick cup, soft cup, hard cup. That depends on the physical activity. Like if you are a virgin, there are cups that suits your need. That you may need small cups. So like that, there are so many criteria. So you just go on a check. Because why I'm not telling gynec is because not every gynec will recommend you. Some will say that it is dangerous. Don't use it. So if your gynec is very outspoken, if she is really into this idea, then you can ask. But if there are many gynecs who will tell you not to try all these things, so if that is a problem, you have to ask somebody else. You just you can ping me, I can forward you.
I guess the change is starting in right, only starting right now in every field, be in medicine or in our
It is like it is a high time. No, after these many years we were just dumping waste, now it became so big that you can't neglect it. That is in front of your eyes, you have to do something. So everybody will start talking about it. When we talk about it, we come with alternate solutions, and that's how it works.
So next question is, what is the normal menstrual gap and what is the natural way to get normal or get back to normal?
I think 25 to 45 days is normal. Anybody having that thing is fine. Again, hormonal imbalance is the reason for irregular menses. It could be PCOD, it could be thyroid. So once you check that root cause of it, then I think you can get back to normal. There is nothing called normal. Like each one's normal is different. So you have to find your own.
Okay. There's another question. My menstrual cycle is only 2 days. So is it normal?
For some people, it's very less. But you have to check your hemoglobin. For some people, when they are anemic, they get very low bleeding, scanty bleeding. So you have to check it. If your hemoglobin is correct, then it's fine. 2 days is fine.
Okay. And Sanchita asks, how safe is the use of methyl and painkillers during menstrual pain?
Not safe, actually, because in the long run, every month you take that, you're adding toxin to your body. But in case you have to travel and there is no other way, you can take once in a while, but not regularly.
So Alexa says, many people were telling that we should not perform advanced yoga postures other than relaxing postures when we are in menstruation. Is it correct, ma'am? If yes, then why?
See, inverted position are not advised. That is the only thing which is not advised. Other than that, everything you can do. Even a person who is doing yoga during pregnancy, if they are comfortable, we tell them to do everything. Only in first trimester, we tell them to take the inverted position. Like there is a change. Physically, there is a change, right? There is your uterus, the shifting position. So your blood flow, why we recommend yoga? Because there is going to be a change in blood flow. So that is the same thing why you should not do inverted poses. When you do Sarvangasana or Shirshasana during menses, so that it interrupts with the normal blood flow, because blood flow through gravity only, like it has to go down only. When you do like that, there might be a problem. But there are a lot of people who do that, because when you are taking yoga class, you can't miss 5 days. So you can keep advanced poses very mildly, like up to Upavishta Konasana, means up to leg raising you can do. Don't do Viparita Karni or Sarvangasana. That is the thing. Other than that, you can do everything.
Okay, ma'am. So they were asking, people asking for your contact details. So can you screen share that last slide from your PowerPoint?
Yeah, I can do that. Actually, that is not my number, okay? This is my mom's number. Who is the one in charge for that? You can take this for pad inquiries. But if you have any inquiry for me, I'll put my contact number in the chat that you can contact me in WhatsApp. But just send me a message. I don't know if I will have time to pick the call. Okay. Okay, so this is my personal number. This one you can ask doubt regarding naturopathy, yoga, or whatever your queries. This one for pad inquiries. This is a number which you can for a placing order or to clear your doubts on pad. Okay.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much.
Welcome. So are we done with it?
Yes, ma'am. Yes. Thank you so much. Thank you for spending your time with us and giving this enlightening session. I all that I feel is this should reach to every naturopathy student, irrespective of their gender. It should reach them and they should be able to practice it by themselves and also tell it to people to whom they care about and their patients.
Actually, what I used to feel is we have so many naturopathy hospitals in India, right? So we talk so much about detox. We tell we have a Jalaneti pot, an enema can in our store. So I think like that, we should have cloth pad because most of the people doesn't know. So when they come to a detox session, we can introduce them to sustainable lifestyle practices and we can introduce the product to them also. So this is what I used to think, because a naturopathy doctor, when they say, when they heal the body, they should be able to give something to the environment also, right? We have that responsibility.
Yes, ma'am.
So that was my idea in spreading naturopathy, this to naturopathy fraternity. So let's see, there are a lot of doctors here. Hope so you will take the words.
Sure, ma'am. We will surely get in touch with you. And as you said, it is a great idea because when people come to our facility, we introduce to them like Sutra Niti and Jalaniti, which normal people like, wow, what are you even doing? Is this normal?
Yeah.
So at the supervision of a naturopathy doctor, when people can do even those things,
yeah.
I think we as naturopathy doctors, we have so much of influence over patients and we can give positive feedbacks to them so that they will try to adopt them in their lives as well.
Yeah, for that first we should experience it. I wish that first when we experience something, no, because even when we practice Jalaniti only, we will be confident enough to teach. So same thing, when we use it, we know the benefit, that automatically without our the intention, it will come out to the patient.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you so much for spending your time with us. Thank you, participants, for joining with us today.
Yeah, thank you. Can I leave?
Yes, ma'am. Sure. Thank you so much.